Brent Yearsmith. I have Jandre on camera, Sam and Dangerous Dave out in the other vehicle, and we have Rebecca and I think it is Kirsten in final control this morning, but it's still quite dark. I'm quite excited. Fresh tracks everywhere. Sam's going to go check for those lions. And thanks for the updates. They were up in the Juma Dam cam around midnight. And I've got a spotted cat feeling this morning. So we're heading off to the southwestern corner. And we're going to start patrolling the southern boundary, hoping for any sign of Queen Karula and the latest progeny. But great to have you on board. Very excited. It's quite warm this morning. About 18 degrees Celsius, which is, I think 70 odd Fahrenheit, 64 Fahrenheit, and hopefully there's lots and lots out there this morning. Very, very still. There's only a Cape Turtle Dove telling us to work harder, work harder. So that's exactly what we're going to do and see what we can find. Definitely warmer than it was yesterday. That could be from a little bit of cloud cover we experienced overnight, keeping in some of the heat of the day. I think there is going to be a particularly pretty sunrise this morning. Glimpse of the horizon as we pop out onto the open seep line at Zoe's Ballinaitis Junction. But first, I'm going to just double check that we don't miss any tracks here. I do love this time of the day, just before the sun creeps above the horizon. It's also one of the best times of the day to hear the big cats vocalizing. Look at that. Isn't that just a gorgeous view? White-browed scrub robin in the valley. Oh, excuse me.
Bless you.
Me sneezing. And Natasha Dobie says, let's go find Queen Karula and the cubs. I couldn't agree with you more, Natasha. Just listening for a few seconds. Yeah, some of the seed eaters waking up as well. Sounds like some canaries. But no vibrating hyoid apparatus to let us know where the big cats are, so we shall continue to check for their tracks. As we continue south, let's go see what Sam is up to in this gorgeous early morning.
Good morning, everyone. You are on board with Dave and Sam this morning, and we are just on Biffles Hook Cutline. We are very excited to go and drive down here to maybe see if Kijima is around this morning. As you can see, we've got some clouds above us here that are telling us that it is quite it's not chilly, so it might seem like it's quite cold and chilly this morning. really that is blanketing us in here and keeping us quite warm down here. But to our right, we have quite a large herd of impala that are just nestling up in the open areas. Can you see them there? They've got their coats up, so that'll tell you that they are trying to keep warm on this coldish morning. And all we can see at the moment are the females. I can just see the females. Let's just go along, see if we might be able to pick up the male that's in this large herd. Doesn't seem like there's a male. So there was a reporting of a lion pride, or it was a male lion down by the Juma Dam at 12 o'clock this morning. So we've just come around this area just to check and see if there's anything that's looking quite unsettled. And as we can see, there's the male. Well done, Dave. You can see the male walking in between the females that he just left. So as we know, the rutting season has been going quite strong. If you move to the right there now, Dave, just saw there you go, the male. Looked like he was chasing off another male. Yep. So he just left us now. So we've started off with there we go, you can see in the distance a whole bunch of moving, and it's a really tiring work for the male antelope, as he has to bring the herd together and look after them. He doesn't have time to groom himself, and looking after these harems of females is exceptionally tiring, and that gives the predators the best opportunity to kill, because they're not focused on looking for a predator, they're focused on courting the females. So it's always a difficult time. Do you hear that? What a sound to wake up to. Those males make the most interesting sound. Awesome. So that is some impala that are rutting over there. The males are rutting. We are going to move forward now, just a little bit away from this impala herd, to see what we might be able to find this morning. Maybe we might be able to find those lions that you saw, and potentially Kijima the leopard. So let's go a little bit slower along the road and see what we might be able to pick up on. The impalas look very, very, very relaxed. So let's go to an area where potentially there isn't an animal that's quite so relaxed. So we're going to go towards the hyena den. I think that's a good idea. Just check it out, see what it looks like. Maybe they're active, I'm not sure. But in the time being, go and see what brings there. With this dry weather setting in, we are getting a lot of fantastic elephant sightings. And we've got a young Ellie bull, probably around 20 years old. And he's found, unbelievably, some form of grass or herb to eat that has been missed by the other elephants. It's actually grass he's feeding off there. Still a little bit of nutrients, obviously, even though it is a bit dry. I'm trying to listen carefully to see if there's not possibly a bigger breeding herd that he's shadowing, but it doesn't sound like it. And it's not unusual to find elephant bulls of this age on their own. They've sort of been
kicked to the peripheries of the bigger herds. Sometimes they also form nice little bachelor groups. Ah, there we go. I can hear some other ellies in the distance. Hello, mister. I'm quite sure we're going to see quite a few more ellies on the Sunrise Safari. So while it's still cool and the sun hasn't quite peaked over the horizon yet, I'm going to leave this boy be and try to keep on the trail of the big cats. Hi, mister. It sounds like there's a bigger breeding herd in the block there. Maybe they'll pop out towards the treehouse waterhole a little later. Thank you very much, Deanna. Deanna says, Brent, great scarf. Deanna, it's called a kikoi, and it is from East Africa. And they are useful, very, very useful. Can be used for multitude of things. Can be used as a sort of man skirt. It can be used as a scarf. It can be used to cover cameras from dust. Very, very handy things. And I have quite the collection of the different colored ones, but this is one of my favorites. So we're now on the southern boundary and we are checking or any sign of the queen. So while we keep checking the southern boundary, let's go see what Sam is up to.
So you just saw the sun rising with Brent while he was sitting with an elephant. I'm not sure where he was, but I know that he's gone off to see if he can find the big cats this morning. We have come to the hyena den. I know Cats in Tampa was quite interested in seeing what might be happening, but we've come here and it's very, very empty. So we went to both of them. This is the southern den and we went to the northern den and both were inactive. So it doesn't seem like they're here today. I've been here three times now and they've been inactive. But Dave was here yesterday with them and he saw the hyenas around here and I think they were playing around here. So potentially they could come back. I know that I'll be in this area this evening to see if I can find any cats. But I can't even smell or hear a sign of them. Linda would like to know if I got my scarf from Brent. No, I got my scarf from a really good friend of mine, actually. Her name's Megan. She's a good friend of mine from Cape Town. And my family love these things. We get them from Kenya, called kikois. And they're really nice to wrap around your neck and keep you warm in the morning. I've noticed that Brent does it. Normally, I just use it. They're also really nice colors, so I just leave them in my room. I use them as a towel quite a lot of the time. So yeah, I really, really love them. They're so nice, really, really comfortable, and they keep me warm in the mornings. So, look at those pink. I just want to look at those pink that's coming up on the clouds here. You can see that nice, it almost just looks quite interesting. It's the blankets on top, and the sun is just rising towards that blanket, and it almost looks
know what it looks like actually. It just looks awesome. It looks really, really cool. So let's follow the sunrise and potentially go in a direction towards Buburu, because we know the lions came, or they potentially could have come up this way. So they could have crossed off into Bufalsort, but we'll go down, see if there's any tracks crossing, and also see if Kajima's there, because Kajima's often in that area. So see if we can find some male leopard tracks and watch the sunrise and get a feel for what's going on in the ecosystem this morning. Last night I had such a fun drive. It was really, really cool. Saturday night drive, James's last drive, and it was just good banter. It was, you know, James has been a really good mentor for me while I've been here. He's helped me a lot with all my learnings and learning the roads and learning all the bird areas where the nests are. So very grateful for all the work that James Henry has helped me with over the last, I think it's been 6 weeks now, huh? So much deserved break for James. And I'll be off in 2 weeks. So it's my birthday on Tuesday, which is exciting. That's in 2 days' time. I turn 26 years old. Obviously, it's also my twin brother's birthday, because we're twins. I haven't seen my brother in, I haven't had a birthday with my brother in 3 years, because we're always doing such interesting, different things. But we'll always Skype each other on those days and send each other a nice long message. We're a coalition of brothers that we keep in contact in different ways, even though it's not often that we're together. We're still very, very close. So, you know, as I'm driving, just take a look at that sunrise that's going there. So we're going to have to communicate through David this morning. David's going to be our communication, because the sound in my earpiece is not working. So Dave, what was that question?
Lucy is wondering, where have the hyenas gone?
Lucy is wanting to know where have the hyenas gone. Well, Lucy, I'm really not too sure where the hyenas have gone. There's no even, there are some tracks coming in and out, but Lucy, you know, it's not that they've changed den. They definitely haven't changed den. Maybe they just haven't come out yet. I mean, it is still quite early this morning. The sun hasn't properly risen, so maybe they still have to come out. They could also be out feeding, or the cubs are getting to that age where they can leave the den for a bit longer than usual. It's having another look. There's the other den. So we were at the northern den. This is the northern den. We were at the southern den, and the hyenas are living in that termite mound there. And there seems to be no activity. So we're going to continue in this direction, follow that sunrise. Let's go to Brent and see how Brent is doing with a buffalo.
Oh, there we go. From one member of the Big Five to the other in the sunrise, we've got a small breeding herd of buffalo. Doesn't look like they've been harassed too much last night. And at this time of the year, when you see a herd of buffalo, you almost immediately wonder, where are the lions? They look like they're waking up and starting to head south across our southern boundary. Oh, sounds like there are more off to the south. Interesting to watch buffalo's sort of general demeanor. You can almost always tell if they've had a hard night being chased by lions, just by how jumpy or nervous. She's looking a bit stiff, a bit of a limp. Oh, she's got sore back legs. Looks like her back left is what she's trying not to step on. Now, that would be, she'd be an ideal candidate for the lions. Now, quite often when they get up, because they have been sleeping all night, there's a little bit, it could be just a little bit of stiffness, and they can work off some of those injuries quite quickly. Difficult to say, just seeing her as she's woken up. Let's move forward a skirt. Hello, Flows. From what I can hear, off to the right, and having a look back to the left, there's probably 100, maybe just over 100 buffalo in this little herd. Lots of dust tickling the nose. Oh, excuse me.
Bless you.
Dust's getting through this morning. Oh, look at that old female. Now, that is a seriously old female. Come out to the right a little bit, please, John. There we go, lying on the side of the road. Look at that. Missing hair, broken horn. Quite an interesting sort of looking buffalo. It's sort of like the buffalo, if they could talk, it's the one you'd want to have a conversation with. Keeping a wary eye on us, that young bull. Oh, the oxpeckers, look at them. Greeting all red-bulled oxpeckers. You can see that little oxpecker that doesn't have as red as the adults, so it's a juvenile. So Nick's wondering if we find an animal that's been hurt naturally, so maybe a huge gash from escaping lions or like that animal that was limping there, do we ever sort of step in and help?
Yeah, I will be once.
Nick, and of course, that injured animal is a prime candidate for a predator. Let's move on past the buffalo. Just be on the grandma's radio for a second. Hello, buffaloes. Hello, mister. There's a nice big bull. Sorry, missed that. Well, let's leave the buffalo to start their morning. And see what else we can find down the road. Lex, there's a family of Nyari at Shivan Junction with Gowrie Main and a single elephant bull, Zoe's Junction, Philemon's Cutline. AFM. We're just checking very carefully here. This is the area Krula's been in and out, in and out. Sarah would like to know, are there any new lion cubs to report? Sarah, not since the Styx cubs were born. I haven't heard of any other lion cubs just yet. But the one sad thing is these buffalo have been up and down all around here, which is going to make finding Karula's tracks, unless they are literally smoking hot, really difficult. See, they just moved and up and down the road over the night. So at least we know if we find a Karula track, it's going to be very fresh. Side. There's lots of dust over them, buffalo tracks over them, so those are the ones from yesterday morning. And you can see all the spots of buffalo dung on the road where they've been. Closer inspection. Look!
Sunrise.
Ah, Jandre has spotted the sunrise. Quite glad he spotted it. Yeah, let's try and get the say when, Jandre.
You can just remove the power.
Yes. If we could, we would remove the power line. So what I might do is try sneak a little bit closer. Should we get past that marula?
Yeah.
Quickly. Then the next marula gets in the way. Sun peeking up in between the two cloud banks at the moment. The golden orb of light. Anne-Marie says, what a beautiful sky, pale gold and mauve. And look at that. Watching for solar flares, Jean-André. Beautiful. So we continue to check the eastern boundary very carefully. Let's go back to Sam for an update.
Brent is off to go and have a look at that eastern boundary. Myself and Dave were following the sunrise, and then we got wind that the lions were heading in a northerly direction, northeasterly direction. So we thought, let's go down Mbubu Road, see what we can see, if there's any tracks on the road. So far, no tracks. No sounds of any animals getting upset with the sound of a walking predator in the area. What was that?
Sarah Wood would like to know if there's any
updates on the line. Sarah Wood? Hi there, Sarah. Just to let you know, my comms not working very well, so my communicator this morning, my translator, rather, is dead. And you were asking, Sarah Wood, are there any lion cubs? No, Sarah, you know, that pregnant female was with James yesterday, which was awesome. So all five Uncle Hoomers were together in the morning yesterday, and she is still looking heavily pregnant, which is fascinating, because I would have said that she looked like she was ready to give birth soon. But maybe she's just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So we'll have to find out. I'm looking forward to seeing if I can find her this morning. If I can find her, then we can identify a little bit more on how she's looking, Sarah. When I last saw her, which was a week ago, she looked like she was ready, or less than a week ago. It's a nice bumpy road. And we're back. Very, very strange temperature this morning. It's actually rather warm. I got dressed as if it was going to be freezing cold, but it was actually rather warm. Okay, we're going into the drainage line now, and I always like to keep it down, keep it quiet when I go into the drainage lines. There's always a chance of seeing an animal, so I asked Dave to see if he can point it left and right down the drainage line, have a feel for what it's like to go into these areas. In these areas, especially on cold mornings, but it's not such a cold morning this morning. Just look down here. So it is fairly empty. Let's keep going up the hill. Coming now to Juma Dam. Juma Dam will be on our right. That's where the lions were spotted at 12 o'clock in the morning. So that's a good 6 hours ago. So they could have, you know, in 6 hours. Imagine a lion walking for 6 hours, you know, they're nocturnal animals, so they could have easily walked from here, gone towards Wilfelsoek and Torchwood. So we've got to try and find any sort of remnants of their time down in our area. I think it must be the Nkuhumas. Claire in New York is asking the question, if an animal gets a thorn in its foot, how does it manage it and does it work its way out? You know, I've never actually seen an animal with a thorn in its foot, but I would assume that they would try and get it out as easy as possible. But most of the time I think they don't have like picky fingers where they can pull and push on things such as elephants and all that sort of thing. And elephant skin is very, very thick. Very, very thick, which is something we were talking about yesterday around ticks. Why is there not many ticks with elephants? And I forgot to mention that the skin of the elephant is so thick that it makes it difficult for the
for the tick to bite. So now we're on the drainage line. Have a look at that. That looks really, really beautiful. So that's where the camp is. Slowly but surely, we are now moving towards and along the drainage line. So let's see if there's any tracks. No tracks at the moment. From what I got of that message, because I'm only receiving 3 out of 5, is that would something to do with coming and helping with the breeding herd of something. Sorry, I didn't quite get that message. Rebecca, could you try again? Oh, so, okay, Nick, so if we found like a lion or a leopard cub and it was hurt, would I step in and much like with a buffalo? Do you know, Nick, we wouldn't step in any circumstance, you know, we would have to let nature take its course. And, you know, I've been in a position where I've seen cheetah cubs who look like they don't have their mother, so they're most likely not going to make it. But you can't intervene in those, in that. It's not for us to decide. That's the thing. It's a problem sometimes. And so we feel like we feel the need to intervene. Have a look at these birds over here. They're just on the, it's a crested. Hold on, let me see if I can get closer. There they go, they're going up into that termite mound there. And now on the other side. Yeah. Again. Crested barbet. And there's the olive thrush. Yeah. So you've got a few birds. Oh no, that's an arrow mark. Look like an arrow mark babbler. So that would be the first one. Is that the first time for you there, Dave?
Yes, it is.
So, but if that is a babbler, there should be more of them around because they are gregarious. So you can tell it's a babbler purely because also the eye and also the streaking that's in front of its body there. And it looks like it's cleaning itself, which is quite cool to watch. But it's got a reddish eye, reddish black eye. It's got all that streaking in the front there, but they mainly are with others, which is interesting. And they make quite a sound. Oh, there we go. Well spotted, Dave. Dave and his bird list. Not only is he spotting the other bird of the babblers, but look at them all cleaning themselves in the morning here. Preening. You can see quite probably that red eye of the babbler now. As he shakes its body. There's another one. There's two. It's very cool to watch them clean themselves like this. Hag would like to know, would I be able to answer why a bird's head bobs up and down when it walks? Never thought about it, Hag. I think it's just the way in which they walk that it makes their head bob. Yeah, I'm not too sure, Hag. I've never really thought about how the walking affects their head structure. It's a good question there, Hag. But this is really interesting to watch. It can still be cleaning itself of any parasites that might have jumped into its feathers. So where's the other one? The other one is on the floor there. There's another one there on the floor. So we've just seen two. Normally you see a few more. Is that a new one for your list, Dad?
Yes, it is.
So Dad's got a new bird to his list. As well as the crested barbet. So they've gone. They've left. How we can see the sun rising over this termite mound. Looks really, really nice, actually. But But so termite mounds are quite an important part of the bush. Of course, they provide a huge food source to everything out here, but just importantly, we were standing on the termite mound. Wow, that's an incredible picture. Great filming there, Dave. We found buffalo yesterday when we were walking, and the termite mounds allowed us to stand up and look over into the distance to see if there was anything else, any other dagger boys or buffaloes around. So it just creates the ability to see what's going on around the bush. But that is an amazing picture there of the silhouette of a knobthorn tree. Aaron's bird list just got to 35. That's very exciting. Aaron and everyone else, we're about to go down into a drainage line again. So let's... All right, so you'd like to get to 40 today, Aaron. I'll do my very, very best, see what we can find. We've seen a crested barbet and an arrow marked babbler. And now we're going down into the thick drainage line again. We might be able to see something that's slinking off into the distance. A bird that likes the colder areas. Let's see what we might be able to find. Something so mysterious about drainage lines that I just love. There doesn't seem to be anything down there. I can't see any tracks. No tracks here. Any lions?
James Richard would like to see a zebra track.
James Richard, you would like to see a zebra track. James, I'm going to do my very best out here to see if we can find you a zebra track. Firstly, probably it'd be easier to find the zebra itself because they like the big open areas. At the moment, James, we're in quite a thick bush and the zebra don't really like this area. If you find zebra here, you're quite lucky find them here. So we need to get to the open areas where we live, in that open areas by quarantine, and I'll see if I can find you a zebra. And then not only a zebra, but its track. It's quite interesting. It's around the mating season for some of the animals now. So between April, May, March, April, May, June, is when a lot of the species like to mate, because coming towards the winter season, and it's the best time to have their litter. There's an impala just in the thicket there. Is it an impala? I just saw something running there. Let's just move a little bit forward. As I was saying, this time of year is important for them to, well, start mating, because most of the animals out here, which have like a 3 to 6 month gestation period, they'll be able to have their babies in the raining season when the rains come in October, November. So we might just see some interesting behavior. Yes, it is an impala. You can't see it right now. Don't have to look. It's just walking through this thicket. So this area is very, very thick and dense. Trying to see any bird that might be popping out of one of these bushes and trees. And we'll make our way towards Buffleshoek Dam just to see if there's anything that's in that area. Maybe we often see the Nkuhumas by Buffleshoek. I truly wouldn't be surprised if we found those Nkuhumas just sitting up by the watering hole. Hold on, this is Tom. I keep saying that I'm gonna get a new tusk for Mr. Ellie. I think it's Tom. And this will give us an opportunity here. Tony would like to know how Elvis is doing this morning. There he is. I think he's just feeling a little bit tusk-less. Sorry about my hand getting in the way here, but I need to
Well, this is not going to work right. I'm going to have to do this a little bit later. At the moment, let's just do that. And it looks like he's eating or mulling. We've spoken about what elephants do when they mull on a tree. They take it and then they put it through their mouth and they just turn the stem of the tree or the branch. And through just turning it, they can both pull off both bark and the leaves. So it looks like Mr. Ellie is mulling a branch right here. Elvis Ellie. So there's been quite a lot of mist in the mornings lately, which is quite nice. It's kind of sets quite an interesting scene. Sunrises have been incredible. So let's have a look down the road, see if there's any tracks in the road. No tracks here, so we... doesn't seem to be any tracks.
Anything.
What was
that
there?
Ima was curious about Wildfire Street. We worried
about wildfires. Who was? Ima. Ima, you are interested in wildfires. Thank you, Translator Dave. Appreciate it. I just thought it'd be interesting here to just show you what a civet track looks like. And then we'll have a quick chat about wildfires. It's not, the sun's not shining in on it, so it's not going to be easy to see. But I just thought it's such a good print of a civet. Did you be able to get that?
Yeah.
I'm just going to jump out of my vehicle for 2 seconds. So I'm going to get back to your question now around wildfires. Ooh, we've just got a vehicle coming behind us. But I'll take 2 seconds to show. Here's the civet track. Over there. And that is, it almost looks like it's quite squashed in, if you have a look there. So that's what a civet track looks like. So I know it's not a zebra track, James, but a civet track is nonetheless quite interesting. And I'll just say it again, it kind of looks like it's been squashed in like that. So I'm just saying hello to some friends who are in the vehicle next door. Right, so I think that's Lex. Lex Hess. He's off going to track the lines from that end, and I'm off this end to see if I can find them. So let's see who sees it first, myself or Lex. Or maybe they've left our property. But Ima would like to know about wildfires. Wildfires, you know, they do occur. You know, in Cape Town, which is a great question, in Cape Town, in terms of wildfires, it happens often. And it's actually really good for the regeneration and growth of protea plants and ericas, which is the indigenous endemic plants there. So that it actually helps seed pods to burst and break. And that's very much the same here in the bush. The fires is a common thing, as you can imagine. Lightning and all that sort of stuff will have an impact on this bush, and there will be wild rampant fires. But it's a common thing, and we do have to deal with it in terms of land management every now and then. Well, every single reserve has to deal with wildfires when they do happen, and we've done all our training procedures on how to deal with wildfires, especially so that it doesn't destroy the houses and that sort of stuff. So fire is a very, very good thing. Very, very good thing for any bush. It helps the regeneration of soil. It helps with the growth of new pioneering plants. If you've heard about, I think it's panarchy, the panarchy and ecosystem succession, about how pioneering ecosystems work, and how, you know, you start from the bottom where there's nothing, and then you get a few pioneering plants, and with those pioneering plants come more biodiversity, more diversity. And eventually the panarchy shows that something will intervene and it will go back to a state where it has to start from a pioneering. So all ecosystems around the world will go through different states where they'll be high in biodiversity and low in biodiversity. So fires are very, very good for any bush. They're just not so good for our human settlements, of course.
And they do, of course, kill quite a lot of wildlife, tortoises and many things. If there was a fire that happened to be here in the bush, we would have to control it to the best that we can, otherwise we'd just become rampant and move in all different directions. I've just heard a Crescent Franklin going. Just want to pay attention to that quickly before I start answering. So the sounds of the bush will tell us many, many different stories out here, so let's just see what might be going on around here. Crescent Franklins are not a very reliable resource in terms of, you know, predators being around, but sometimes they can show you that something is lurking in the area. So I'm deciding to go off Central Road and onto Nyala Road North. Sometimes we have problems with signal here, so please be aware that you might lose us for a second, but we need to do it to see if we can find those lions potentially. Dina would like to know, how with the drought can we fight fire? You know, Dina, it's really difficult sometimes for fires to actually, you know, they have to jump quite large areas, especially in the drought conditions when there aren't that many leaves on the tree and the trees just aren't as full and thick as it is in summer. So it's actually quite hard for them to jump across to other bushes. So it's quite easy, it's much easier to regulate. Here goes the Steenbok. So the Steenbok just ran through here. Once again, this is another drainage line area. So I'm just paying attention to the sounds of any birds or herbivores that might be alarm calling at anything. And just have a look here. It really is my favorite road. As you're following this drainage line all the way through, and it's such a pity because we have such bad signal here, so I never drive it, but you know, it's a special case. Let's see what we can find. I know there's some really beautiful birds that you get in this drainage line. Okay, so I just got a part of that message, so let's go and see how Brent is doing wherever he is. The time being, we're going to see what we can find in this drainage line. We'll see.
Sorry guys, just on the game drive for a second. Standing by.
Copy, thanks Exiana. I'm not sure. I think if I remember correctly, Tsalala Pride had 4 or 5 females, but if there's no tailless line there, then I have no idea.
This looks like they found another pride of lions to the north of us, and no one's sure who they are.
So it's not the Tsalala pride, there's no tailless female.
Oh, mystery lions, how exciting.
Aha! Oh dear, this is not good. We have found the tracks of the Inca Hummus. Okay, so it looks like, unfortunately, here go the tracks of the Inca Hummus pride, heading towards the eastern boundary.
Sorry, just listening to the game drive radio, lots of chatter. Okay. Come on, lions. Go left or right. Don't go straight. Oh, tracks disappeared. Where did you go now, lions?
You got anything your side, Jean-Dre?
Just buffalo. Lots of buffalo tracks everywhere. Go back down the road a little bit to see exactly which direction those lions went in. Carefully there. HKP is wondering, can we recognize a pride by their tracks? Not necessarily. The reason to know this is the Nkuhuma pride is because they've literally walked from the Juma Dam camp. We're heading in this general direction. I've got a line track here. I think just to the north of Pipeline Junction. Now, there's always a possibility that the lions might change their mind, so that's why we're checking carefully. Now, there's just so much buffalo activity in this area that I'm pretty sure that these lions might have been chasing them. I mean, it's just pandemonium when the tracks are on here. Morning, Jamal. Jamal would like to know, how many lion prides are there in the Juma area? Well, Jamal, our main pride is the Nkuhuma pride, then there's the Styx pride. At the moment, there's been quite a lot of movement of prides, so we also get the Tsalala pride and the Mangeno pride. So it's four. Plus the Birmingham Male Coalition and the Salati Male Coalition. Now, the difficult thing is here, there's just buffalo running, and it's very difficult to see any tracks. So I'm just gonna listen for a second. Those might hear the growling of lions on a buffalo kill. Something in the bush here. Yeah. It sounds like elephants in the distance. Miranda is wondering, how do the lion prides get their names? Well, Miranda, it's generally from areas where they spend a lot of time. Well, the Nkuhuma pride was first seen under a large brown ivory tree. And Nkuhuma is the Shangan for brown ivory. That's how they got their pride. Tsalala pride is also named after a tree. It's the Lofelt gardenia, but more because they spent a lot of time around a place called Tsalala Pan, which is on Londolozi. And then the Mangen pride is because they spent a lot of time around an area called the Mangen drainage line, or Mangen little river system on Londolozi as well. The Styx pride
It's a very old pride, and I'm not sure exactly how Styx got their name. I remember it is something to do with the river Styx. I think they were a very big pride when I first got to know them. And I think they sent a lot of passengers down the river Styx to Hades. Safari Dean's wondering, is it because a lot of the cats, or big cats having cubs at the moment, they don't mark as much territory, so newcomers sort of sneak in? I don't. I think the reason the lion behavior is so topsy-turvy is because of the male-lion coalition shift. So I know the Matimbas were up here recently. They were being chased by the Majingalans, and the Birminghams run back and chase them the other way. So I think these female prides are trying to sort of hide from this male-lion battle that has been going on to the west of us, and that's why they've popped up into this area. Yeah, well, it looks like the lions have headed into Torchwood, so we're gonna turn around, see what else we can find. While we do that, let's go see what Sam's up to.
Here we are at Biffleswick, and we are just looking over the other side of the watering hole, and we can see some crescent franklins that are just great, well, just eating some seed pods, particularly maybe they're eating something off the ground. They can't see. We're actually very, very far away. I'm just looking through my monitor to see what might be going on. But we have some other special guests here this morning in the watering hole. Can you see the big lump? And there is a hippo. So the hippo most likely would have been grazing out on the land for the last couple of hours and has now come towards the watering hole to lie up here for the rest of the day. Here we go, we just got some water out of the nose from the hippo. We've been really, really privileged to see hippos out of the water recently. It's been very, very cool to see that. They look so different, and they're such large animals. You can quite clearly see quite a bit of mud on the hippo's back there. And here's his ears. You just saw the ears moving. And his eyes that are just above there. So that's our friendly hippo that we come and have a look at down by the watering hole. I just thought, while we're here at the watering hole, let's also just kind of see what's going on. If we pull back and we have a look at the water's edge here, we've got quite a lot of tracks of elephant as well as lots and lots of dung. So there's probably been a big, big breeding herd that's come here recently. You see that dung there? That's the elephant dung just by the water's edge. So potentially we might be able to find some elephants this morning. And to our right, fascinatingly, there's actually a bird here, which is called the yellow-billed hornbill. I'm sure you've all got that to your list now, but it was eating dung, which was fascinating. It was eating the elephant's dung. So look, this yellow-billed hornbill, potentially will jump. And we were just chatting about, I've just forgotten the name of the person that just went and looked up about monocular vision and birds. Really, really interesting. And why they bob there, Andrea. Thank you, Andrea. I really appreciate when viewers go out and out of their way to look up something that I didn't quite know as a guide. And it just makes that experience so much more richer because we're learning together. So they have monocular vision. And so when they jump on their two little feet there, up and down, and they bob their heads, is because it helps them stabilize their vision when they bob their head up and down, which is very interesting. So we've got binocular vision, and all birdies have monocular vision.
But we've got some more birds up here. We've got some buffalo weavers up in the tree here. This is a Balanites tree. You can see the nests here. It's incredible. You can't see them right now. Those nests are quite large, as you can see, but you just saw a bird flying in and out of screen there. There's two of them. They're flying around the tree. That is our red-billed buffalo weaver, and that was actually the bird that we had at camp for a couple of days that then passed away. Buffy, red-billed buffalo weaver. We tried to raise it, but it was too damaged. But you can also hear the sound of another bird, which sounds like the orange-breasted bushshrike, so hopefully we can see that in a few minutes. So this is a beautiful tree, the Balanites, as we're looking here. And fascinating little bit of information. There's another bird, Cheapest Dave really wants that bird list to get up there. That's a Birchall's starling that's on a buffalo thorn there, so I'm sure you've got that one already. You could potentially go looking for the Cape Glossy starling. I don't know how this is helping Aaron out there. I'm sure you've got some of these already. But there's another bird that's just down here that's popping itself around the dung. What is it? It looks like a pied wagtail. Isn't that awesome? It's incredible. When you just stop and look around, you can find so much. I've seen 5 or 6 birds already. Incredible. So that's the pied wagtail. I'm very used to the Cape wagtail in Cape Town. Chris would like to know if there are any crocodiles in this water. Chris? There are no crocodiles in this water. We would see the crocodiles, and I've never actually seen a crocodile in this area. All that I've seen here is a hippo. I haven't even seen a young hippo. I know that they saw a young hippo on Arethusa the other day, which must have been very, very fascinating and cool to watch the young hippo. So there he is. But you can hear that. You can hear that. Listen to the sound of that bird call. It's just gone silent. That's me making that call, by the way. That's not the bird. So I don't mind making bird calls when it comes to trying to make a lion roar. It's not the easiest thing for me to do. So when you listen, I'm just going to do it one more time. Sounds like the orange-breasted bushrike. Let's see if we can find it. I'm just going to go slowly. Not easy to find some of these birds. It's birds like the gorgeous bushrike, the orange-breasted bushrike, all the different shrikes are hard to find because they like to find. Wow! I saw it. Just watched a bird. Look, it's in the water there. Oh, that was so cool. So go above there, you'll see, just above there he goes again to the water, skimming the water there. Awesome, that looks like a buffalo weaver. Let's watch that again. So it looks like it's hawking, and it looks, from this distance, it looks like a four-tailed drongo. I can't quite see from here. But it goes down and stands on a position there, and it starts hawking, so it'll drop down and fly in the water, collect some insects, go back to its position in the tree. So there's a few of them there. I can't quite see. So maybe they're starting. Let me get my binoculars out. So awesome to watch them do this. The drongo, the fork-tailed drongo. Watch it just skim the water there, collecting some of the insects. Great filming from Dave. There he goes. Awesome. Oh, wow. Very cool to see that. Let's watch one more. I'll watch you dive from the top there. So I'll say again, it's called hawking that they do here.
Hold on 1 second, guys. You can quite clearly see the fork. There he goes. Oof. Did he get something to eat? Did it? It's actually so cool to watch this. And they're also cleaning themselves, or they're going down, they're collecting an insect and then trying to get the water off them. But that could also be a way in which they clean themselves. Very cool. Jen B is asking, could they be bathing? They could very well be cleaning and preening themselves there and not actually collecting insects, but to me it looks like they're actually... Whoa, I don't know. Can't get close enough. Let me actually see if I can see any insects with my binoculars lurking on the top of that water. I cannot actually see any insects there. So it could be very well that they're just going down, dipping themselves into the water, and then cleaning themselves as they come up onto the branch. So that was spectacular bird behavior. So it's been a very birdy morning so far. Let's see what else we can find. Let's get you to 40, I think. Was that for Aaron, to get you to 40? Let's see if we can do that for you. Chinspot Batis. I just heard that one. Let's see maybe if we can find the chin-spotted batis. So from tracking lions, as we just heard, the lions went from, I think Brent would have updated you, we were tracking the lions all the way up here. I was up one road following those tracks and we found that they had crossed north. So not northeast, so they're out of here. Brent's got a large animal. Let's go and have a look. Another Eddie bull, a little bit older than the one we had first thing this morning. I can hear other elephants in the bush to the east of us. He's probably heading towards there. Such a big animal can be. See how he's sniffing, looking for the scent of the other elephants, so he's tracking them by smell. Sniffy, sniffy, sniffy. Standing by. We're on pipeline, on Hippo Pools itself, about 10 meters from the junction with Cheetah Cutline, and then they've headed sort of slightly east, sort of northeast into the block, and then I lost the tracks where all the buffalo were running. So Deborah is wondering if I've ever seen an elephant so mad it was whipping its tail. Now, when an elephant's mad or upset, Deborah, they don't whip their tail, they actually just sort of straighten it so it becomes sort of stiff and erect. So he's heard those elephants, I could hear, off to the east of us. Oh, we can hear them in the distance.
HKP's wondering how old this Ellie is. I'd say he's probably mid-20s. Mid to late 20s. And he's off to find the rest of the herd that are in Torchwood that we can hear. So just a quick update. No updates from a cheetah plan this morning. They've checked for the cheetah. No such luck. So we're not going to meander down there. I think I'm going to go have a good look around the western sectors now after checking the Mwati. There's of course always the chance that Kruger's managed to sneak across because of all those buffalo tracks up and down and around, as her tracks might have been hidden. So we'll go have a quick squiz around Treehouse Waterhole and that general area. Suddenly got colder and quite a big cloud bank has rolled in. Lindsay Lou would like to know what it is like living in the bush and working in the bush. Are there upsides or are there downsides? Well, Lindsay, I've pretty much lived and worked in the bush my whole life. I've lived in the... Well, but even before the bush, we lived on a family game farm. So no real city time for me, apart from a brief period in Johannesburg. But there are, of course, upsides and downsides. I personally wouldn't want to live anywhere else but the bush. But I would say one of the downsides, and I think Jeanne might agree with me on this one, is that sometimes it's a bit difficult to get really good seafood out, yeah? And it's always quite nice to have some sushi and some prawns and things like that, so, but we do that when we're on leave. Jeanne doesn't agree. Jeanne doesn't like seafood. No, he doesn't like seafood. Jeanne doesn't like anything, guys. He's very fussy. So, of course, upsides, downsides, but I would say the upsides definitely heavily outweigh the downsides. We also live in a sort of a very small community. Well, Nick's wondering what was my scariest moment. Well, Nick, it probably happened about 2 years ago, and it was in the Central African rainforests. And I got tossed by an elephant and dislocated my hip. That's probably been the scariest moment for me. Apart from, also I would say actually having to drive, also in Central Africa, driving a very small boat over very big waves in a very big storm out at sea. That was quite scary. Amazing how the weather just changed so quickly. Must be a cold front on the way in. So John's asked us to look out for an aardvark track. I shall certainly do that. I'm trying to remember, we did see one earlier this morning. Ah yes, I remember. We'll try to get there. Unfortunately it was on Gowrie Main, so it could have been driven over.
but we will go have a look. Sandy's wondering how far is it from camp to a town where we get supplies. Our closest town where we get most of our supplies is Hoedspruit. There are some smaller villages and whatnot a bit closer, but as the crow flies, it's probably about 70 kilometers, but driving just over 80, 90, and probably it takes just over an hour, depending on the state of the road. Probably closer to an hour and a half at the moment, as the roads have become quite bad. So here Sam is on a birding challenge this morning. So let's go see what little feathered friend he has.
So we have just seen quite a number of birds that are flying around. There are so many birds actually in this area. Once again, we've got some drongos that are flying around. We've had some small little waxwills, blue waxwills, some firefinches, and we're trying to lock on them. So like trying to get a good picture of them without them flying out of screen. It's really, they're not helping us at all by flying away all the time. It's really hard to stay on one of them. There's one there though. What bird is that? I can't quite see what that is through there. I think that could have been that chin spot batis. I saw it again. So let's just continue, because otherwise we'll go crazy trying to get all these birds. There are quite a number of them. It doesn't seem like... Ooh, can you hear that? Okay, so we are close to some elephants. The sound of a hornbill. There is an elephant somewhere here. Can you hear that, Dave?
Yeah.
That was a very loud break of a branch. Just looking in every direction to see where this elephant might be. This is definitely not a small elephant from the sound, the crack of a branch that I've just heard. Where might you be? It's not like you are a small animal. See you soon. Just gonna switch off again. Okay, so let's just pay attention to this elephant at the moment, because I'm not sure where he is in it. Here, I can definitely hear the sound of an elephant very, very close by. Very, very thick bush here. So I just want to pay attention at the moment. I just received a message from James Richard. Rebecca, could you go on that again for me, just as I was looking for an elephant there? Question from James is similar to some other animals that can track down scent, you know, if they've lost someone. I think that was if they lost one of the younger individuals from the herd, would they be able to track down that young baby elephant? Yes, you know, they would be able to smell. They've also got a way of communicating. So we're just going to go up here to see if the elephants are here. That is also at a hertz level that's much lower than ours. So we hear sounds at 25 hertz. Elephants can hear sounds at 5 hertz, which, of course, if they needed to make a contact call, they could make a call like that if they lost the young within the group. But I think the general question was asking if they could actually follow up on scent. And I'm sure they can follow up on scent. I know that a male will do that for a female. When they're looking for a female on estrus, they're actually able to smell sometimes the scent of a female that's in estrus. Oh, it sounded like that elephant was on top of our car. How loud it was. I know that Mr. Ellie's on top of our car, but he's not quite the sounding of an elephant that I heard just now. Potentially he's up in the bush somewhere close by. So where we are at the moment is we're just coming up towards Cheetah Cut Line, and that's where Brent was not just a few minutes ago, finding that those tracks had headed in that direction out of here. Wow, no idea where that elephant has gone now. Must be deep in the thick bush there, just cracking and breaking on branches over there. Lindsay Liu would like to know, what is my opinion around working in the bush? What are the ups and the downs of it? Well, it's a good question, Lindsay. Like, I've only been here 6 weeks, as I've been started my job 6 weeks ago. And, you know, the upside of this is that for me, you know, there's elephant tracks everywhere here. So if I don't see an elephant soon, I'm going to be surprised. You know, for me, the biggest thing that I love about being in the bush is the fact that I get to be immersed within an ecological system of this nature, you know, in terms of the richness of the predator to the herbivore that lives in the African bush. I just find it so really, really good for my mind and my health, just because I'm fascinated by the way in which animal behavior works, the way in which ecosystems are, and how they benefit us. And also just living out here and learning and not being a part of the city, which for me is I don't do as well in the city as I do here. I think the downside for me is not having my family around. I think that's a hugely important thing, is the relationships that you hold in life. And, you know, to be away from my parents and my brother, mainly my twin brother and my sister, for 6 weeks at a time is difficult, just because he's going through the same sort of motions in life. He's been 25 years old, trying to start a business in Cape Town, and, you know, all I can really do is chat to him over Skype and messages, as well as my sister, who's a lawyer. She's an environmental lawyer. So that's the downside, is that I don't get to be close to the relationships that I really, really, that I really cherish and like to look after. But then again, you know, I'm following and I'm pursuing my self-value, if you will, in terms of learning what I love about this world, learning more about the natural ecology. And I'm going home in just a couple of weeks, so I'll get to spend 2 weeks with my brother and my sister and go surfing and swimming and do all those great things. So that's probably the answer to my ups and my downs. You know, the ups are way, way more than the downs, and I try and stick in that pool of positivity. Really, really nice group of people that we live with in camp. It makes life so much easier. You know, the people that you associate yourself with make a big difference, and the people in camp are just great people. I really like spending time with them. And then, of course, if I wanted to get away from the camp, because it's also a very small community of people, I've got this whole community of other beings, such as elephants and lions, leopards, plants, all sorts of things out here that are part of this biotic community of life on Earth. So there's more individuals than the humans, and I truly believe that I'm building a relationship with all the different components of this natural world, even the stars. To sit outside and watch stars at night time make me a very, very happy person. So that would be my answer to those questions. Myself and Dave actually love to go out at night time and check what stars we can see. We often say, who can see the first satellite? So we just sit looking up at the stars, trying to find the satellite in the stars. And every single time we've played that competition, we've sat there for about 10-15 minutes. And we both haven't seen a satellite. And normally we always see satellites. It's strange. Yeah, you can see that those Nkuhumas have crossed. Got a vehicle. I'm just going to move off here. Let's cross to Brent in the meanwhile. We'll see you just now. Cheers for now.
Hey. So we're back down in the south. No luck on the eastern boundary. So we're just slowly making our way towards the treehouse waterhole. See if there's any action around there. I haven't been to treehouse yet, so I'm quite excited to see how much water's in there. That is an elephant dragging his toe, making me think there might be a drag mark. Oh, hello, mister. Nice big. Nyala bull. And his orange socks. Oh, look at the tears in his ear. And you can see that's another sign of age, but you can see he's old just from the size of his horns and how worn they are and how the ivory tips are starting to show. There we go, there's the orange socks. I'm going to move forward, let's go. Now, he's eating a tree. We don't normally see the browsers eat, but we are in a very dry period, so that's why. And he's eating a monkey orange, a strychnos. Now, there's quite a few different strychnos species. I mean, here, the most common is the one that he's eating there, the black monkey orange. But the Indian counterpart to the monkey oranges of Africa has got a very high strychnine poison. And the Thuggee, which were a band of, basically a caste of thugs, for lack of a better word, in India, used to actually use the fruit of that tree to extract the strychnine poison and commit assassinations. We are going to definitely see quite a few animals eating stuff we might not normally see them eating, especially not this early in the dry season. And it's going to be fascinating to watch the trophic levels and how the different animals feed off them. And we will definitely keep a close look on it, and you will see how different animals feed at different heights, and there's sort of bands of where they've been fed, where the plants have been fed on. We just heard something, so we were just listening. John and I heard something behind us. We're just trying to figure out what it is. Pretty sure it was some Eddie's screaming, but quite far away. Anyway, well, let's continue on. So Brian's wondering what animal gets most affected by the cold. Well, in my experience, Brian, it's actually probably zebra, strangely enough. So specifically now that we're going into a very serious dry time, and if any of those zebras are not quite at optimum health or a bit old, the first really cold snap of the year, when it drops below 10 degrees, which I don't think it's done yet, often causes quite a few zebras to die. They just don't wake up from their evening snooze. Not. I'm trying to keep a good lookout for example. Oh, yeah. Glossy starling. Lovely, lovely orange eye. Looking for some ground insects. There we go. Breaking open some elephant dung that termites have started feeding on, so going after the little worker termites in the dung. Such beautiful birds. Now, that iridescence is quite important in starling, so the brighter and shinier you are, the more likely the girls are to find you good looking. Also, when starlings aren't too bright and shiny, it's a sign that they're in poor health. Obviously, this guy is not in poor health. Oh, what's he got there? Something a bit bigger. Looks like he's actually just breaking up some porcupine dung. Oh, there's some ants there. That's what he's after. No, he doesn't seem to be after the ants. After something else in the porcupine dung. Such a beautiful bird. And now, looking at this guy, he's going to be able to tell me which glossy starling it is. Is it? Let's have another last look as he comes out into the open here. Is it the Cape glossy starling, or is it the greater blue-eared glossy starling? So let's see which birders are on form this morning. If you know the answer, and you've only got two, so you got a 50% chance of getting it right, send through your answers to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Well, we continue on towards the treehouse waterhole. Let's go see what Sam's up to.
Welcome back, everyone. As you can see, I'm outside my vehicle, and I made an explanation a little bit earlier about mulling and how elephants like to mull and put things into their mouth like this. And then they chew it around and take off all the bark and the leaves and the branches. So you can actually see over here where the elephant has actually ripped it from there and eaten it all the way down here. And this is a Sisyphus tree, or a buffalo thorn rather. If you have a look at the thorns, you can quite clearly see is a hook thorn there and a thorn that points out. So this is a mechanical defense from a tree to protect itself from different herbivores. But interestingly, why I'm actually here is I came across a log on the ground as I went off the vehicle, and just have a look at this nest that looks like has been made in there. Really, really, really interesting. I'm just going to open it up slowly. So this is an old piece of bark, piece of wood. I'm just going to open it slowly to maybe reveal what we might have. Sorry, I just flicked that into my face. Have a look at that. That's so interesting. I wonder what kind of animal did this. It must have been a spider, of course, but which insect was it? So it's amazing. So termites would have probably eaten away at this log, and there's quite a little soil in here, so they would have closed it up where they can, the termites, and then because they've, well, as you can see, they've left this dwelling behind, that it created so much room for other insects to nest in here. And as you can see, the nest actually goes right in here. It's fascinating. Whoa. I'm just going to break it open a bit more. So, whoa, oh my sweetness. That just gave me a nice fright. I just got a fright there. I'm just going to show you slowly what I just came across. As I was opening, it seems that there's a dead spider in here. Just in case it's not dead yet, I'm just going to make sure. Here it is. It's dead. Jeepers, this is unreal. So I wonder how it died, or it could be the exoskeleton, but you can see the spider that used to live in here. So I keep moving it around. There we go, Dave. Gotcha. Isn't that fascinating? So we just opened up this piece of wood. We found some signs of something that was here. And then we came across this spider. Not sure what spider was. It gave me a huge fright when I saw it. I'm just going to turn it like this. Because you can quite... If Dave, if you would be so kind as to go as close as you can to the teeth of that spider. So the front there, quite clearly see the teeth of that spider. How awesome is that, guys? So as much as they are large animals, it's just as hard to find the small ones. And we've just managed to find a very interesting looking spider inside that of a tree, dead old log. So that's another, as I said, another great example of how things in the natural world, you know, really are contributing, creating space for something else. You know, trees fall down, trees become then the decay that allows for other animals to inhabit it. So that gave room for the spider to inhabit that. And I'm not sure what would have killed it, that spider. But I got a fright when I saw it because I opened it and one of the legs just was on my finger, and I was like, jeepers, is that very close? So you have to be very careful when opening things like that, just to make sure that it isn't a poisonous spider or a poisonous snake in there. So I made quite sure I lifted my finger out like that. Whenever you lift something out in the bush and you're trying to look for something, always open it the other way. So here's a log, or here's a rock. When you open to see if there's a scorpion down there, open it that way and look round and then look in, rather than opening it this way, because then you are opening yourself up to a snake that might spit at you. You might open yourself up to a scorpion that might come out and sting you. So always be careful when looking around in the bush. But, well, not just the bush, go look around at your home, see if there's any old remnants of different insects that might be crawling around there. Siberia Zumi said it could be a jumping spider or a funnel spider. Yes, that I remember that spider. It could very well have been that spider. Funnel web spider. Because it did have that, from what I remember, it did have that very, like, almost vortex.
What did you get that?
Maybe even a wolf spider.
Maybe even a wolf spider. Who knows? We'll go back and have a look at our spider's book and see what spider was lurking in there this morning. All right, so let's move on our trip. See what else we might be able to find this morning. I would like to know, you know, what is the snake populations like here in the bush? Snake population, I haven't seen a snake actually since I've been here, it's all 6 weeks, but we're also getting to a stage where the snakes don't like to be seen and they're going down and burrowing in their nests. You'd also like to know if they're quite poisonous. Yes, we do get, venomous. We get some venomous snakes, not poisonous. Venomous snakes that we get here, there are quite a few of them. The black mamba, the boom slang, and of course they have different kind of impact, like they have a different way of affecting you. So you have the cytotoxic, which is the snake or the spider even that bites like this, and then it affects that area. Cytotoxic, it affects the tissue around where that bite is made. Whereas a neurotoxic is when the bite goes into the bloodstream and the venom goes into the bloodstream and then it starts attacking the nervous system of your body, which is much like the black mamba. The black mamba is both cytotoxic and neurotoxic. And then there's another snake that's hemotoxic. Actually makes you bleed from some of your orifices, which is, just forgotten the name of that snake that is hemotoxic. I think it is the worm slime. I'll have to come back to you on the hemotoxic snake. And you also want to know if there's any anti-venom in camp? Yes, I think they do have anti-venom. They put a huge first aid kit there. Huge first aid box of all the different things. Let's go and see how Brent is doing wherever he is on the property while we look for some animals. Oh, he's just going to stay with us because that's a cancelled link. So stay with us. You're on board with Dave and Sam and Ellie. Let's see what we can still find. Are there African anacondas, says Leopold? Good question, Leopold. There's something called a rock python. A python here, we get you. So it's a really, really, really big snake. Huge, actually. It's much like the anaconda, but it's obviously, well, it's not as big as the anaconda. It will eat baby bush bucks and all that sort of thing. I've only ever seen it once, slithering into the bush. Jeepers, if you see one of those snakes, it is quite scary to see them. But it's also so incredible to watch them as they devour something. They'll eat the whole thing and then it'll go into their bodies. But sometimes when they come across other predators such as a leopard, a lion, or even a human, they will regurgitate whatever they were eating at that present moment. And then slither off as quick as they can. I was in Brazil. I went looking for an anaconda. Never quite found it. I didn't know if that was to my delight or to my happiness, or I don't know. I really wanted to see it, but then also it could have been quite scary while I was on foot looking for one. Walking around the Amazon River to see if I could find an anaconda. It's quite an interesting thing to do. I did find many other animals, such as one of the small jaguars. Lots of other snakes, loads of snakes. Saw so many snakes there. Beautiful animals, beautiful looking birds. The Amazon and Pantanal. All right, we're just coming towards the leadwood tree. Have a look, this is the leadwood tree. You can see a bird on top of it. This is a starling. This is one of my favorite birds or trees to look at. So I'm just gonna stop. So you can see it from that position, but let me just roll forward.
There's a bird just at the edge there. It just flew off. That was our starling. This is one of my favorite trees to look at, because the leadwood is such a long-lasting tree, and it's got quite a hard wood that they used to use with an infrastructure and building, but also they also used to make canoes out of it, boats, because they're quite, you can easily make a nice, oh sorry, they didn't make canoes out of it because they were too heavy. That's right, they didn't make canoes out of these deadwoods. But they are really beautiful trees, and they can still stand here for about 800 years. So for 800 years, this deadwood might still go to, which will be fascinating to see what it sees in its life. The life of a leadwood tree in the bush. What does it come across? Katie would like to know what my favorite animal is in the world. Now, I've been asked this a few times, and I think I said one of my favorite birds was the black eagle. I'm just thinking about what my favorite animal is. I'll just get it. Just give me 20 seconds. Just while we go into the drainage line, Dave can look left and right, see if he can find anything in there, and I'm going to think about which my favorite animal is. That's actually great into the drainage line. I really do love elephants, and I do love squirrels. I love elephants and I love squirrels. But to be honest, I love more the behavior of something, so the behavior of an animal. So to be honest, if I'm sitting with a wild dog and it starts to play, wild dogs playing, I light up like a little child. If I'm sitting with young elephants and I watch them play, I get that same feeling, and just as much when I watch a buffalo and an elephant interact with each other. So I'm really, really fascinated by behavior and how mammals behave to each other, but how birds are wow, look how many butterflies there are. Butterflies everywhere. If you can see them, they look like the monarchs. Wow. So let's continue down the road, down the drainage line. So you're on board with Sam. But I also, you know, I also love marine. Like I live by the coast. I live on the ocean in Cape Town. And I love surfing and I love bodyboarding. So I love to bodyboard and surf and swim in waves and do all that sort of thing. And so I really enjoy some of the marine animals, like marine ecosystems. I'm actually going to try and do my marine Fugaza, which is my nature guide to come for marine ecosystems. So learning about limpets and periwinkles and orca whales and humpback whales and the diversity of different types of algae you get in water, and yeah, so fascinated by it all. There's so many butterflies along this drainage line. It's awesome. They seem to all be the monarchs flying around. Whoa. So we're just paying attention for anything that might be sleeping, resting around here. I actually had the most incredible experience with an orca just about 2 months ago with some of my friends. We went off on a boat around Cape Town, and next thing we just saw, I don't know what you call a group of killer whales, do you know? Group of killer whales, maybe a pod of killer whales, or I think it is a pod maybe. And we came across these killer whales that were swimming in the water. I'd never seen a killer whale. And next thing we see it come, we see one of them on a small baby humpback whale. And we saw a whole group of orca whales killing a young humpback whale. It's the most interesting thing I've seen. One of the most interesting things I've seen in the natural world. Here we go. Hold on.
which is also fascinating, is that the orca has a matriarchal leader, much like the elephants have matriarchal and the hyenas. And they were all killing this humpback whale. And the way in which they were killing this humpback whale was just by jumping on top of the humpback and trying to submerge it underwater. And that's basically drowning this little baby humpback. So this is very, very fat. Yeah, it was so amazing, actually. I can't even get over it. I couldn't believe my eyes when I was watching it, actually. Okay, I reckon we got a treehouse dam. Let's go to a treehouse dam, right? Dave, let's go see what's going on there. You guys all keen to see what might be walking around treehouse dam? Potentially a large breeding herd of buffalo. Logan. I have a good friend of mine called Logan. It's a very cool name. He lives in Ladano, close to me. I'd like to know, Logan, where are you from? Oh, well, the elephants have really crossed our path today. As you can see, we can't go that way. So let's try the other way. So Logan would like to know more about water tortoises. We get what we call terrapins here. So they're almost in between a turtle and a tortoise. And we get two of them here. The Marshall terrapin and the serrated hinge terrapin. And if you stay on board with us for a little bit longer, we're going to head towards one of the watering holes where we can most likely find a terrapin. Also love terrapins. They're very cool to watch. Still on high, low range. I just saw something walking through the bush here. Could have been a little steenbok. This is also Karula's territory, and maybe there's every chance that Karula might have crossed back in. So I'm going to do a loop and just see if there might be any Karula tracks lying around. I know Brent came down here and drove this cut line to see if there was anything there. That's why I'm not going to drive the cut line. I'd rather drive in and see what maybe can find in here. I haven't seen Karula for a time. We saw Karula last week or so with her. So you can see the elephants have been here. We can see some trees. And there's a question coming through. I'm not getting it. What is it? What was that question there?
Are tortoises
hibernating at this time of year? Well, we've seen quite a number of the tortoises. I think I read briefly that was Searle. Was that Searle who asked that? We have seen quite a few of the tortoises around lately. But they do hibernate. They'll go into an area where they'll close off and not feed as much. They won't go and feed as much because it gets quite cold in these conditions. Hopefully we can find a tortoise. I've seen quite a few of them. We saw a huge leopard tortoise just yesterday. We still will see some tortoises even into the winter, drier season. Okay, so we're now coming towards a treehouse dam. There's also more drainage line to our left here, so I'm just trying to see if maybe there's a kudu and a nyala that might be lurking around. So this is also where we found a drag mark of a hyena. I was very, very interested to see it. It was, came down here and I found tracks of hyenas everywhere. And next thing, myself and Vian, all the way from here, for 2 kilometers, followed drag marks of it must have been a hyena that took it all the way down there. I don't know if you guys remember this, but it's incredible to see how far it had been dragged. Eventually we found an impala carcass just laying there, and it must have been a hyena that killed it. So just want to be careful of dung beetles. Sometimes when you are driving, there's some dung beetles on it. Most of the dung beetles have gone now, but we've seen quite a few, and elephants obviously like to leave their dung on the roads. So it's just important that we don't run over those dung beetles. Really, really beautiful. I love dung beetle. And I know James and Aaron, if you're still watching, that you're quite keen to catch on the birds. So I'm also keeping an eye out for our birds. I'm still looking around. There doesn't seem to be anything in this drainage line. What would you like to see at the drainage line? What would you like to see there, everyone? We're coming towards the watering hole. So maybe we'll see a buffalo, maybe we'll see a hippo, maybe we'll see any sort of animal lurking around that area. Hopefully we can find a zebra, because I know James Richard wanted to see a track of a zebra. So we're just gonna have to pay attention as soon as we get there to see something that's walking through here. There was a huge, huge breeding herd of elephants that were here just the other day. And this over here is the part of the round leaf teak over here. It's a round leaf. So the scientific name is Pterocarpus redundifolius. And this is the one plant and the tree that the elephants love to eat. And I just love to look at the way in which water is dispersed and nutrients flow into the leaf here. And you know what's fascinating also? Is that this is a natural solar panel. So we all talk about solar energy, PV panels and all that to create sustainability. And these plants are flexible, they can turn in every direction, and they are collecting sunlight from the sun and making energy through photosynthesis. Okay, so we are at the dam now. Let's go slowly and see what we might be able to find as we come up to it. We can find, I see some dung on the ground. Charlie would like to know, couldn't I have just gone around the road and gone around the tree there to go across, Charlie? Charlie, we've just had new rules implemented that we can't go off-road at all anymore, especially going into this dry season. It's not good for the habitat, it's not good for anything out, especially out there. We can't even follow tracks out there. So we're gonna have to come and move that tree on foot later, rather than going off-road. But I also don't enjoy going off-road when I can. I feel that it's, we don't need to be that obtrusive. Hopefully we can find the animals and then we can go off-road. But it is, it's getting into a drier season, you know? So in the dry season, the sand is not as compacted as it is in the wet season. And so obviously when we drive over and all that, we can take more of the natural ecology and the habitats here. So we always have to be quite careful when driving off-road. But there are signs of these elephants everywhere. You know, when I was, I truly love being on foot, and that's something that I want to try and bring to
to the various viewers out there is that when you are on foot, you see things very, very differently in terms of how to view a buffalo, how to view an elephant, how to view kudu and all that, because you have to be that much more secretive. So if we can bring more of that surprise element to our drives, that's why the bushwalks are so incredible. Look at this. These elephants have gone absolutely crazy here. So there's trees on the roads everywhere. We're gonna have to just drive over it. Hold on, everyone. Right, we're here at the watering hole. Maybe, there, through the thicket there, you can see a kudu that's just on that damn wall. Let's just look at it for a second. It hasn't noticed us yet. I'm just going to reverse it a little bit. We'll let go. There we go. So that's a female kudu there. And it looks like it's looking around. Why I stopped to have a look at it from a distance through the trees here is because I'm really trying to bring that secretive element in, because we can start learning a little bit more about their behavior, on what they've seen, what's going on there. So that was a youngster, so that was really cool. She just got whiff of our scent, and the female mother's just ahead of us, so that was a young kudu there, and the female's going to be walking out through the bushes. There she is. As she comes, you can just see her through it. You can see those nice white stripes on her body. Beautiful. Look at those ears. Those ears will be pointing in every direction there they go. Because the youngster was looking very, very nervous. How cool is that? So we crept in here and we came across a beautiful young kudu and its mother. They've just gone off into the bush there. They probably just came and had something to drink down by the watering hole here, which we are now coming to. Awesome sighting on this kudu. Wow, so the watering hole is looking quite a bit drier than usual. But we've got a nice big buffalo bull that's coming in to the watering hole this morning. Looks like he's just been grazing. Jeepers, he's a big, big boy. He is huge. See what he does. It will be interesting to see him jump into the water. Logan Brock would like to know how many different watering holes are in these areas, and are they a few territorial animals that will be around these waters. So Logan, there's quite a number of watering holes that we get here. This is Treehouse Dam at the moment. We've got twin dams where there isn't any water at the moment. I still watch this buffalo drinking. And then we also have Sydney's Dam, but which is not on our property, but we can view it from a distance. And of course then on Tuma we also have the Buffalo's Hook Dam, which is my favorite watering hole to go to view different animals. We often see the large breeding herds of buffalo coming through there, and often the elephants that are drinking and playing there. And we have a territorial, so going on to your next question is, do we have any territorial animals that are in those areas? So you would have seen that hippo that we were with this morning at Buffalo's Hook Dam is really, really quite large, and that would have been a male hippo that is holding territory in that watering hole. So that is a territorial hippo at the Buffalo's Hook Dam. And of course many, many different other animals will also try to create dominance around the watering holes.
You know, often if there was a number of buffaloes here, old buffalo boys, and they didn't get along, because often you have bachelor herds that form, but there can be a bit of tension between two buffaloes when at a watering hole. So, for example, the other day where we are filming at this present moment, there was a buffalo standing here, and it tried to go down to the watering hole to get something to drink. And the other buffalo came and charged the other one, or charged just made a really, really loud sound, and that buffalo then went in a southerly direction, and we didn't see that buffalo again. So buffalo can be territorial, especially when it comes to grazing the green grasses that come around the watering holes, as well as sitting in the watering holes themselves. But we can also be aware that other animals, such as the wildebeest, a male wildebeest that holds its territory, likes to hold its territory where there is a proximity to water, as well as nice grazing pastures, and will be very territorial to any other wildebeest male that comes into the area. So that's a big thing within animals, is who can get the best water and food. Red dog would like to know, do the female buffaloes fight with one another? No, I haven't seen any females fighting with one another. I've only ever seen the males fighting with one another. Of course, that probably is in other situations. There has been probably two females that fought with each other a few times. I've just only ever been aware of the male buffaloes that bang those bosses against each other and they have really, really big fights. But what's so incredible about the shot, though, quickly while we're there, is you can see a nice reflection of the buffalo in the water, which looks quite cool. Have a look at that. You want to get a screenshot of the buffalo's reflection. He's looking into his morning mirror this morning. That looks very, very cool. Let's see what he's doing. So it looks like he's drinking. And the chances are this buffalo won't move much further than where he is at the moment. He'll sit in this watering hole and just enjoy being in the water, as well as drinking and grazing around the edges for quite some time. So it's always very important when walking this area to know that there will most likely be a few of these big boys around here. That is such a great picture. Well done, Dave. Look at that. Got the nice reflection of the buffalo. Ooh, interestingly, we've just had another buffalo that's come to the party at the watering hole today. There's one that's just to the right of us now. Let's have a look. It also looks like a big old buffalo bull. He probably has already been in the watering hole. You can see quite a bit of mud on him and quite a bit of water, looks like. So he's probably been at the watering hole. What's interesting is that buffalo down there is actually looking at the other. I think it was your question, Logan. We might just be able to see that behavior happen and unfold in front of us between the two buffaloes. So the one down there is now drinking. The other one is now making its way down to the watering hole, slowly but surely. Actually fascinating to see how these buffaloes will interact. Ellen in Arkansas was quite interested in learning about, you know, how these buffaloes become solitary and leave the breeding herds. Well, these are the big old bulls, and you can tell that they're old not only by their bosses, but how they've lost quite a lot of fur on their back, and they've lost quite a bit there, if you can see it. So they need to get to the watering holes and get away from the sun as best as possible. And they can't actually keep up with the breeding herds as much as they used to be able to. They've become a lot slower. So it's easier for them now to just sit in one place, drink and graze, and, you know, kind of live there for the rest of their life, than trying to keep up to those breeding herds. But still, you'll still find some of them that try to keep up, and those are the buffaloes that mainly get taken by the lion prides, the trailing buffaloes that are too old to keep up with the herds. And sometimes you find that with the females. Let's listen to the interaction between you. You can just hear something. Did you hear that? It was almost like a greeting between the two. Look how much mud is on this buffalo. Logan, I hope you're watching. There has been a little bit of interaction between the two buffaloes. The one's now moving away. Fascinating to watch this. That buffalo doesn't like him here. Hear that? I don't know if you were able to pick up on those sounds that that buffalo was making. He was making quite a loud, not louder than you could hear, but it was almost like that sound of the elephants make. Almost like a growl. It sounds a little bit like a growl. But let's look again at the one at the back. He seems to be a little bit more dominant. He's got a lot of mud on him, so he looks like he's been playing in the mud for quite some time. So he's now getting back what looks like his watering hole. There's another great reflection of a buffalo in the water. That was awesome. So that little bit of interaction between the buffaloes was fascinating to see that. And it looks like the one buffalo is probably going to be heading off now. And the one that came back down from here, so is now grazing. Ooh, it looks like this one's actually going to come back. It's going to start to reposition, get a new fresh angle on this. Two big buffaloes down by a treehouse dam. So we're going to get into the dry season soon. Let's just get one more angle of this. Get up nice and close to these big boys. So the dry season's coming up and the vegetation is going to be coming a lot more drier, a lot more bare. The leaves will be falling off the trees, and the water here is most likely going to dry up in the next couple of months. Probably in the next, maybe even in the next month, there will be no water in Treehouse Dam. So this is going to cause a little bit of a panic in some of the breeding herds of buffalo, and it's going to just create a lot more room for the big lion prides to take some of the buffaloes. We know that the Birmingham boys, well, apparently I've never seen it, but they love to eat buffalo, so we might just be seeing a few hunts in the next couple of months. I think let's have our last look at this buffalo before we move on to see if we can find any tracks of Karula coming around this area. Alright, so we're going to go off and see if we can find some tracks or to see whatever's out there in the bush. If you're also interested in learning anything else this morning, from biomimicry to anything that you're interested in, please hashtag Safari Live and we can talk about it till the end of drive. Now, let's go and see how Brent is doing.
So, we're back. Thanks to Connor, who repaired. We had a break in the cable that goes into the antenna. Connor has fixed it and we are out again to see what we can find. So our plan changed slightly. We were heading towards the western sections. We still are going to, but we're going to take a wider loop towards that area and see if there's possibly any sign of the creatures along the Buffalo's Hook boundary to the north of it. Thank you. Okay. Sorry about that. It seems like they've got a few gremlins. Hopefully they...
It's been a while.
Nice to have you back. We're heading along the road now from those buffaloes. Going to go and see what we might find this... Well, we've only got about 30 minutes left of this drive. Look at this dung. Jeepers. So there's quite a lot of dung on the road here. So the elephants are in the area. So there's no tracks. I'm just also going to be checking for tracks. I really want to see a leopard this morning. Nature's Darling, what a nice name, Nature's Darling. You would like to know what happened to that whale, that humpback, after those orcas came? Yeah, so Nature's Darling didn't quite make it. That humpback was killed. From what I noticed on the boat, we were on a boat and we could see that it was floating. But what was fascinating to see was how the orca was just playing with it. The orcas were just playing with their kill, which was quite interesting to watch that. I mean, that was the first interaction I've ever had with orca whales. And I tell you, it's not going to be the last. My plans and hopes and goals in life and my aspirations is to obviously deepen my knowledge of this wonderful natural world that we live in. And I want to get up to the wolves up in Alaska, and I want to go to parts of the world where I can go and see orca whales and go see humpback whales and learn a little bit more of those ecologies. And just learn more about, you know, how an orca lives its world and how it hunts. They're such effective hunters, and they're actually very, very intelligent animals. Very, very intelligent animals. So hopefully one day I can sit down with them. I'm not sure if any of our viewers have spent some time with orcas or wolves of that sort. Those are the two animals I really want to spend more time with, are wolves and orca whales. But as well as the ospreys, and I think that the ospreys are in, is a type of I think, bird or eagle in Scotland. Is it called an osprey or whales? The ospreys in Wales. That's something that I would love to see. If we have any viewers from the United Kingdom or from Scotland or from Wales, how often do you see ospreys there? I'd love to see those birds of prey or the bald eagle. So much to see in this wonderful planet. So I've still got some time. Okay, so we're now on Shabam Road. Let's go this way towards. We're going to go to Philemon's Dip to see if we can see any. Actually, you know what? Let's go to the break. Let's go to the cut line because we might just get lucky to see. Yeah, what does Elvis say? Elvis? Rebecca's just reminded me that I should definitely ask Elvis around where we should go. And Elvis, I think Elvis thinks that we should go to the cut line to see if there's any tracks of Karula anywhere. Potentially there is. I want to see that beautiful female leopard this morning, if we can. Maybe I should just check on the radio. Victor would like to know, are there any updates on the cubs? So this is little Gowri over there, and that's the last time that the cubs and Karula were seen. So I'm just going to look here to see if there's any tracks of Karula crossing, as well as the cubs. So this is where Little Gowri is. Just looking for any tracks that might be around here. Wonderful Karula. Just going to check on the radio because sometimes when I'm live, I can't chat on the radio. I just want to get an update to see if anything's been found. Stations, can I please get an update for... So, we're just having one of those quiet mornings today. Nothing's been found on the property. It seems that the lines crossed over. Karula hasn't crossed back in. And that's just from a cat perspective. But I'd say on safari, there's many, many other things going on at the same time. In terms of termites in the ground and the funny jumping spider that we just found. Maybe we can go and find and track something a little bit smaller out there. It's a wonderful Sunday morning. It feels very much like a Sunday, don't you think, Dave?
It does, yeah.
It feels like a Sunday, a nice, calm, relaxed Sunday. We go back to camp. Maybe Amanda's cooked something amazing. We get fed so well here in our camp. I mean, Amanda made the most incredible pies yesterday. Nice spinach and mushroom pies. Something that's just coming out of the thicket there. Let's just go slowly. It was just some branches coming out of the thicket. I was saying, Amanda makes really, really great meals. She's such an incredible cook, and she's such a fun lady. We were playing some games with her last night until quite late. We were laughing. I haven't laughed like I laughed last night. We played a very, very fun game last night. It's actually called a very, very fun game. At least because we don't have a name for the game, so we just called it, at least I called it, the very, very fun game, just because it's quite fun, eh? Yeah. Rebecca, our director, was making me laugh quite a lot last night. As well as VM. VM just came back from leave. It's good to have VM back. He was only gone for a couple days. He just went off into the Kruger. Have a look. All right, let's go down here and see what we might be able to find. Really see the impact of some of the elephants. I'll show you now. There's quite a lot of impact. Wow. While we're talking about termite mounds, let's just have a look at this termite mound to the right of us. It's going to get into another position. So have a look at this termite mound. Brian would like to know, do people eat termites? Well, Brian, to be honest, I haven't eaten any termites, but our good friend Mr. James Hendry was telling me that it tastes a little bit like peanut butter. Not the best tasting peanut butter you've ever tasted, but quite similar to that. And I've never eaten it. I'm sure you can eat them. But what's incredible is just have a look at the way in which these mounds are structured. And these are coming from, you know, termites look very much like ants. They're very small creatures, but they provide such a huge resource for food. Many, many organisms out there, and even from a, you know, if we went to go put our hand in there, we'd find that the temperature would be around 32 degrees Celsius, which is quite warm, and that helps them with the fungus growing termites. It helps them regulate the temperature to look after that their food at the bottom of these termite mounds. And so even more interestingly is that they found how to adapt that to human systems to make our buildings a little bit more efficient in terms of air cooling. So they actually designed a building in Harare called the East Gate Building. You can have a look at it. It actually is designed in a way in which it learns from the termite mound to cool the building because of that intelligence from termites. So we're learning from little creatures such as termites how to be a little bit more efficient within our building structures and all of that. And I mean, this is... I just heard something. There's an impala's rutting in the distance there. So if we just have a quick look at our flaky thorned acacia over here, with the big, big thorns there, and just have a look at all of those, the size of those thorns are just huge. And you can tell it's a flaky thorn. There we go, look at that flaky. So that's a flaky thorn acacia. And What's quite fascinating about just trees in general is how is water being sucked up from the ground all the way to the top, and how do our, how could our buildings begin to work in that sort of way? How can our buildings not pump, you know, pump things up there, but actually do what nature does to bring water and nutrients all to the very tip of these trees? So learning a little bit more about that sort of design and intelligence is super interesting, and just something that sparked my memories, talking about, you know, do humans eat termite mounds? Well, you know, what's also quite interesting is there's this mouse that's out here. And I was actually studying this mouse the other morning. And it's called a fat mouse. So it really is called a fat mouse. I didn't make that up in the book. It's a fat mouse. And it's more kind of active during the summer months. And it eats as much as it can. I think it's called a fat mouse. It's just eating as much as it can so that in the winter months, it can go into its burrows just below clumps of grass, and it can hibernate there for the winter season. But owls love it because, you know, they're obviously rich in nutrition. And also the human, it's a delicacy for some African people to eat the fat mouse because it's just so rich in fat. So it's a delicacy out here. So hopefully we can find the fat mouse out here. I don't really know what it would taste like. But those are some of the things that some people eat out here in the bush. Never seen the fat mouse. But you know, it's quite funny, and with an interesting fact about the fat mouse is that when it gets handled, it often plays dead. So if we had to hold find a fat mouse and then hold it, oh wow, I'm gonna come just hold it. I'm gonna get off the vehicle now. Just found a really big shell. It's just on the ground there. But I was just explaining to you how the fat mouse will pretend to be dead in your hands. So it'll, if you hold it, it'll be, yeah, so it's quite funny that. And then you put it down, it'll obviously come back to life. But I was just imagining it in the beaks of an owl trying to pretend to be dead to tell the owl that it's not alive. I don't know if that would work so well. An owl. So have a look at this. So it looks like the giant sluggy. Isn't that cool? I'm gonna try something quickly. I'm gonna put this up towards my ear. Just make sure there's no dirt that falls into my ear, because I have been having problems with my ear recently. It's been swelling up because it's not used to the ear pieces since I've been here. So I just want to get the sand out. I can hear the ocean in here, which is quite nice. Sometimes my mom used to teach that to me, putting the shells onto your ear and you can hear the sound of the ocean. But what's also really, really interesting is I want to show you just a little aspect of design here, which I'm super fascinated in. Have a look at that spiral that goes from here all the way around and out. Can you see that? Awesome, huh? And tell me, have you seen that spiral before? Does it remind you of any other spirals that you've seen in the natural world? If you have a look in nature, you'll find the spiral in many, many different things. You can find it in the way in which a wave breaks. And so you can even find it in the universe. So if you stop and learn a little bit more and look into nature, you can start to see these designs and patterns that are just really, really incredible. And that's what sparks my interest. My deep learning about the natural world is understanding these designs that really, really are quite amazing. So I'm going to put you back over here. What I would like to know, what I'm going to look up, is can that be inhabited by another creature and take on that shell, which would be fascinating to learn. I know that some creatures will actually eat shells to get the calcium in the shell, much like how giraffes will eat bones to try and get some of the calcium from bones. I know that that's the same practice in some animals. Awesome. That's a nice little. So on. So I'm just.
What was that?
I'm not reading Rebecca's message. Huh?
Let her go again. I think they've got a. They want to touch the dam camp. Put giraffe and dam camp.
Giraffe and the dam camp?
Yeah.
Rebecca, do you copy?
Awesome, so you're going to switch to the dam camp and still have our audio.
Cool, so I don't know what you're going to be seeing. I think it's a giraffe that you'll be seeing on the dam camp. I think a giraffe will be drinking at the dam camp. Enjoy it. See what you might be able to see. The giraffe has... Okay, so there's oxpeckers
on the giraffe,
I've heard, and that's quite fascinating. So that giraffe, will, if it's quite close to the water there, you watch how it might spread its legs. So potentially that giraffe will be spreading its legs and drinking water. That's awesome. It's really difficult to see what you might be seeing while I'm here. But that's awesome that you can see a giraffe drinking down by the watering hole. We'll move in that direction. We're not so far away from Juma Dam. I hope we can get the last little bit of that giraffe drinking from that watering hole. That's not something that you see often. Welcome back, everyone. So, we just saw a giraffe down by the watering hole. It's really, really interesting. I've never actually I didn't know that we could do that. That's quite cool that we can chat to you while you're seeing things on our dam camp. I know that you guys will often find things like the wild dogs that will go through there, and it really helps us when you find things like that. It's awesome. So we'll slowly move in that direction to see if that we can just see that giraffe for a little bit longer. And I mean, just going back to that conversation that we were having about that spiral and thing, let's just get my book out just before I go there. I'd like to show you something very, very quickly. So we looked at that spiral over here, and spiral. I'm just going to get into a position where I can show you something. So that spiral you can actually see here. So in the top right one, you can almost see that over here. And that's part of the Fibonacci sequence, and if you look in the natural world, you can begin to find that design that is everywhere. I mean, even if when you look at the Milky Way galaxy, you can begin to see that spiral pattern that exists out there. But I'm also fascinated and to learn more about how sacred geometry works and what are our platonic solids from the many, many, here are our platonic solids. I don't really know how to say them. Go close on them. They're different kind of cubes. So you get cubes and octahedrons and all these different shapes that you see here. And these shapes in the natural world are considered to be the strongest, the most resilient. So when you look at a beehive, you'll find that the shapes in a beehive are hexagonal, and those things make for the design of that beehive to be really, really strong and efficient and to be able to grow in different directions. So the building of the beehive doesn't have to be straight like our buildings. It can go up and around. So it's modular design. It's really, really quite fascinating. And finally, if we have a look here, we can find the the flower of life. And in this flower, you can begin to see, a lot of other animals, in their perception, have maybe this way of seeing in terms of seeing basic shapes. So fish are said to see quite basic shapes. And if you look at it, go look in your gardens or start looking at all the different plants that are in your gardens, and you can start to pick up on that shape within the flowers of the natural world. It's super, super interesting. Super, super interesting. I love learning about sacred geometry and how all these strong shapes that make up the natural world. So Brent's back out in the vehicle. Let's go and see how Brent's doing.
So hopefully we're back for a bit longer this time. Again, thank you to Connor. We have now pirated a cable from Wendy to make Rusty work. So hopefully that should fix this. Fingers crossed. Am I still there? Hello, hello. It seems like I'm still there. So I did hear there was a giraffe at the Juma Dam Cam and a possible bird of prey. So let's go have a squint. Apparently it was an African harrier hawk or a gymnogene that was down at Juma Dam Cam. Well, it is now devoid. Oh, there's the giraffe. It's definitely not drinking anymore. Very dark, big male. And you might hear the low rumble of diesel generators humming in the background, which means the electricity is gone. Oxpeck is in tow. Very nice looking male giraffe, very, very dark. And he's looking quite intently at something. When you see giraffes standing like that, sometimes they do spot predators, quite good at spotting predators, or it could be spotting an inyala. Safari Hayes was wondering, is there an oxpecker with a black beak? Very possibly. You can see there are two red-billed oxpeckers, and those are the adults. If you see an oxpecker with a black beak, it's a juvenile. And they've got serrated bills, and you see how they comb through the hair looking for little ectoparasites. Oh, he hasn't moved. He's not looking at us, so he's still staring at that exact same spot. And there's the juvenile oxpecker. Hasn't got his red colouring on his beak yet, the one up at the top. Let's just go have a quick squiz around where that giraffe is staring. Is it? Sometimes they do stare intently at a nyala or a pala. Oh, so not an African harrier hawk, but an African hawk eagle. It's going to get a safety shot. You see him, Jandre, on the wood on the opposite side. A safety shot from here before we go any closer in case it flies off. Here we go, African hawk eagle. One of my favorite raptors we get here. Yeah, well, we've got the safety shot. Let's get a little bit closer. This cold front's definitely moving in. Lots of cloud cover at the moment. Still a bit nippy.
go. There's the hawk eel. We'll stop again a little bit before going closer. Some Nyala on their way down for a drink as well. Such stunning birds. Now, it's possible that that hawk eagle plummeted down here to try and grab a guinea fowl or a franklin, and has now just stopped, or could have come down for a drink. Huh? Unfortunately, we didn't see which. Maybe you guys did on the Juma Dam cam. So far, this hawk eagle's being very obliging. Oh, look at that eye color. Isn't that stunning? So they're great hunters of other terrestrial birds, specifically franklin and guinea fowl. And they hit them at high speed, causing an explosion of feathers. Of course, they will still also eat little myriads or myriads and little rodents, as well as snakes and whatever they can catch. Lovely big group of female Nyala also heading towards the pan. As it warms up a little bit, there's a little boy in there as well, heading down for a drink. I'm going to try edge even closer, see if this hawk eagle is really going to... I think he's about to fly down it. Boom! Oh, look at that, majestic. Very distinct streaky breast. And you can see it's a true eagle, or an Aquila eagle, with its feathers extending all the way to its feet. Well, amazing. Lynn says the bird was there the whole time the giraffe was having a drink. Isn't that incredible? Thanks for that update, Lynn. You can hear the squirrel alarm calling. And then another update. So he wasn't hunting down next to the pan, he was bathing, according to Siberia. Thanks very much, Siberia. There's that. Nyala. Little boys in there. I can see four little males. And we have a beautiful little reflection. Jandre being arty. Look at that, stunning. Oh, look, I got a fright from this impala running in. I don't know what he's up to, but I mean, look at that. They just suddenly disappeared and they're running everywhere. I half expected to see a wild dog charging through, but all there is a male impala. He looks as bemused as why everyone decided he was a big threat. But it looks like he's going to stop for a drink, or he's looking for some ladies. But while we see what pans out here at the Juma Dam cam, let's go have a look at Sam, who's got a piggy to show you.
So we've just come across a nice family group of warthogs here, and you can see there's quite a few piglets. So this is so cool to see. It's not often we get to sit with warthogs close to us, especially with the youngsters here. And it could be two females with their youngsters. But there are quite a few here. And these little piglets must be quite careful, because they can be preyed upon by even the eagle that you're sitting with Brent. Eagles are known to come down and sometimes eat young piglets. But you can see they're great. They eat quite a lot of grass. Most of their food that they eat is the grass, but they also go down to the soil layers where they can find tubers under the ground there. And that's when they get onto what looks like their knees to get to those points. And those are that tail, those tails that are wagging there in different directions. Those are the follow me signs. So if we're lucky enough, as we roll feet forward, we might just see them, those tails go up. So let's go a little bit closer, just as we close the show. Let's just see how... Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to scare you, little piglet. Let's just watch the way in which they lift their tails here. It's fascinating. Just to close the show, we say goodbye to the warthogs. Here they are. Let's see how close we might be able to get to them, because they are very cute. Look at these little warthogs. They're very relaxed with us. This is amazing. There goes the tails. So there the tails were. Thank you so much for this morning's drive, everyone. It's been fantastic. Thanks, Dave and Rebecca. We'll see you this afternoon for the afternoon drive. Let's go and see how Brent is doing.
A drink and a grooming session from the oxpeckers. Spotted the lone impala and descended. You must be a really, really mean impala to cause all the other antelope to run away. Poor Nyala didn't even get their drink, but the oxpeckers are getting one. Such exquisite little birds. Akra says maybe the Nyala thought a predator was chasing the impala. I would assume so, that's what they thought, Akra, but he wasn't sort of running like there was something behind him. He wasn't jogging up towards the water hole. Oh, he's getting a nice groom now. Those ticks out of the ears. Spa day for the impala. So we'll leave the impala to his spa day, getting
preened and cleaned as well as having a drink. I'm going to go see if we can catch up with that giraffe. He might have moved his way onto quarantine. But maybe that giraffe was actually looking at that impala. And they are still rutting, so they are behaving, well, not erratically if you're an impala, but not as they would outside of the mating season. Unfortunately warmed up slightly, even though it is still quite overcast. Okay, so that giraffe walked up through here. He stopped for a meal on the way, or is he on the march after the ladies? It's always so fascinating how quickly giraffe can move. So the origins of the name giraffe actually comes from Arabic, and the word is zarafa, and the one who walks swiftly. And this gentleman has certainly walked swiftly. I can't even see him now. Well, looks like he's swiftly avoided us. Oh dear. Well, hopefully he'll be around for the sunset safari. As I'm sure most of you know, James is off on his holiday today, and so is Kirsten. So you will be having Sam and myself till Tuesday when Jamie gets back. And Jamie is in England at the moment. She went to get her, went to her master's graduation. At Cambridge, very smart girl. But it's been wonderful having you on the Sunrise Safari. I apologize for the tech issues we had. Hopefully we've got them all under control, and we'll see you in a few short hours for the Sunset Safari, and hopefully big cats will abound. So from Jandre and myself, adieu.